Welcome to Italics, television for the Italian-American experience. I'm your host, Anthony Tamburri. This month, we're coming to you from the Calandra Institute, and I'm here with Fred Gardaphé and Donna Chirico. Fred Gardaphé is the Senior Professor of English and Italian-American Studies at Queens College and with the John D. Calandra Italian-American Institute. And Donna Chirico is Professor of Psychology at York College and also resident faculty here at the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute. So welcome everyone, welcome Fred, welcome Donna.
Nice to be here.
It's a bit redundant in a way, but you know, where is Italian American Studies today? Where was it 20 years ago? Where is it today? And what are the prospects? Let's just start with that.
I can say that Italian American Studies is a little more out there than it was 20 years ago, that's for sure. I just returned from MLA in January, and we had a session, you know, proposed and sponsored by the Italian American Studies Association at MLA. I can remember 20 years ago having difficulty getting even a paper accepted on the subject of Italian American Studies at a big place like MLA. The pandemic has certainly thrown a curveball to the people who work in Italian American Studies, and I think they've responded very well. They might not have hit a home run, but at least they got on base with a lot of the programming that's been done in terms of webinars and readings and so on. And so, you know, I think it's surviving. there are many things that I would like to see that we've been working on that haven't moved much ahead, and that's especially in terms of Italian American graduate studies. The Italian Diaspora Summer Studies Seminar was put off for a couple of years, and to me, you know, for some people that might not, you know, what's a couple of years, but for me, I think it's key in terms of developing cohorts of people who are deepening their understanding of Italian American studies and incorporating it into their work, whether it's their work in the classroom or outside the classroom. We don't have the access that a lot of other studies programs have to graduate schools and funding and so on. And so I think while Italian American Studies is keeping its face out in the public, it's time to bring the rest of the body into play on this subject. So.
Well, I have to concur with Fred, and I would just add a couple of points. One is that an MLA is a very good example, which is that Italian American Studies, when it's at some place like MLA, is still not part of the body of MLA. It's still an outsider, right? It's still a special category. And I think that that's something that has not yet changed, right? That this is not a book in Italian American Studies. This is an important book, period. Right? It doesn't have a separate category. And as the groups have grown, and as we have new journals, and as we have more people, I think we have to be mindful that certain synergies are needed among these various groups and people so that we work towards the final piece that Fred mentioned, which is programs in Italian American Studies. And of course, concurrently, programs in Italian, which along with many of the other humanities are being axed all over the place, right? So these are pieces that I think are critical to keep in mind as we now reconstitute post-COVID and start to think about what we want to accomplish in the next 4 or 5 years.
We have more journals, as Donna said. We were at the MLA, as Fred reminded us, that of course has its own history of how that session got started in its own renegade way. But we need to have a venue that prepares the people who will then come to participate in that panel at the MLA and in other places where there might be panels on Italian American Studies. And that's really where I think, you know, the curricular issues are the main concern. Curricular issues at the undergraduate studies and curricular issues, of course, at the graduate studies. And for reasons that the three of us, as well as some of our other friends, have sort of scratched their heads, we're still not in graduate programs. We're still not in undergraduate programs, and we're still not in graduate programs in most or in any universities, I think, around the country.
the key here is to enable the new generations to see the value of pursuing this work. I mean, for me, I had to fight my way into Italian American Studies tooth and nail through University of Chicago. And then even when I got to the University of Illinois, where they were very kind to allow me into their program, when I proposed an exam, for example, on one of my exams be Italian American writers, nobody else agreed to it, primarily, I think, because they didn't want to go do the reading. You know, and they said, well, you've already done that reading. You know, we know you've got that down. You know, let's focus on these other things. And I did, you know, four exams in very mainstream areas, American ethnic literatures and Native American literatures, which was, you know, considered much more mainstream than Italian American, and a couple of other areas. So it still needs convincing, I think, and I don't think it will be, we will be able to convince people until the universities at least allow the possibility of graduate courses to be offered in a much wider range of possibilities.
It's an interesting point, because what we know from data, right, everyone wants to ask us about data and back up your claims. We know that the number of degrees being awarded in various ethnic studies has increased, including at the doctoral level. So it's critical to have a modeled curriculum, right? Starting with the graduate level and then the undergraduate level that other institutions can model, right? To make their own programs, because the interest is there. Ethnic studies, self-discovery, I mean, these are all over the place right now. And it's in many ways the perfect time to open it up to Italian American studies. And I don't buy the claim at all that these are programs for people of Italian heritage. That's ridiculous. When you look at the ethnic studies programs, there are people from all over the place, all different backgrounds, who are interested in issues such as ethnic studies, migration, immigration, and particularly since Black Lives Matter, right? It seems it has increased even more that people want to be aware of our differences as well as our similarities. So to me, this is a very important time for developing the curricular part of Italian American studies.
I don't think this is something that happens necessarily just in the academy. I think due to a lack of informed leadership in our community, the word to the public hasn't really gotten out beyond what academics have been saying. And, you know, I mean, my whole mantra, my whole career has been connecting the streets in the academy. But when Italian American organizations don't support and don't promote graduate study, I think, frankly, because they don't trust it and they don't understand it. And there's always been this fear of the intellectual in America. As America was developing its identity away from Europe, there was this movement, you know, this kind of pushing away the intellectual in terms of things political, in terms of things practical.
So two things. Donna hit on the notion of the so-called relationship between demographics and Italian studies. And Fred, you mentioned basically you're talking about the town gown situation. So let's revisit first the idea of demographics. And this is the whole sort of contradiction or paradox, more than not contradiction, but paradox, right? Is that Dante Alighieri, for example, has never been more translated than in the 19th century from Italian to English, both in Great Britain and the United States, than in the 19th century. And here, of course, in the United States, there were Dante clubs all over, including, of course, Harvard, Longfellow, et cetera, right? But then all of a sudden, something happens where Dante and Italian culture, et cetera, all of a sudden almost becomes ethnic, right? The language itself becomes ethnic because of immigration, and it's taken a long time for us to get over that. I think that's one of it. The other issue is the one of demographics, which of course is the excuse that's been used to cut the Italian studies major and minor at Brooklyn College, as we know is going on as we speak. There's that issue there, and there have been lawsuits involved and things of that sort. And of course the administration at Brooklyn College said, well, after all, Italians have moved out, we don't need, I'm paraphrasing, we don't need Italian major anymore. And that is really an issue, and it's a problem, because it seems that Italian studies and Italian American studies is being measured by the non-Italian Americans within terms of demographics, whereas that doesn't seem to be the case with other ethnic studies.
I've been teaching the Italian American Studies class at York now for 6 years, and I have yet to have a student of Italian heritage. And we offer 2 sections every semester, and they're full and overtallied. So as I said before, people are eager to learn about other cultures at this point. In fact, they're encouraged. Right? City University loves to talk about diversity and inclusion, but that always seems to be whatever the mandate of the day is and for which group. Right? It seems to lose track after a while. It may support some idea of inclusion, but then when the next group comes along, the earlier group is often forgotten, and that inclusion means everybody, and you have to open it up and give people an opportunity, give students an opportunity to choose from an array of classes and not a narrow focus where there are 2 or 3 options for them.
Look, if everybody taught Italian American history and culture within the context of their American studies courses, I wouldn't be so adamant about, you know, the presence of Italian American studies. But they don't. And just because people move away from a neighborhood doesn't mean that a subject of history needs to be gone. I mean, what about, you know, the Black exodus from the South? Does that mean that Black studies doesn't need to exist in Southern universities? Of course, that would be ridiculous to say that. When resistance happens within the academy, the administration has ways of controlling that. But when it happens outside, they can't control it. And without that outside support and without that outside agitation, most universities will just go about their business and cut money where they, you know, where they will get the least resistance outside the academy.
It goes back to your point before about the various Italian American studies groups within education not communicating. And of course, that situation is even more dire outside the academy, with various groups all wanting to be the quote leaders of the community, and they're just not in communication with each other. And this loss, it's a tremendous loss, because if people worked together to push towards what you just described, we would have a very different effect inside the academy.
Even when you get some traction in some of those communities, there's still the issue of the intellectual component, you know? And I say intellectual to avoid academic and to avoid scholarly, right? Because scholars and academics are not necessarily quote unquote public, according to some people. An intellectual can and is very, there are many public intellectuals, right, that we can speak of. So that whole idea of intellectualism just seems to have not taken hold.
You know, for the last 35, 40 years, I've been teaching Italian American studies. And I would say that, you know, whoever has had my classes, whether it's been in an Italian American studies course or in an American studies course where I've dealt a little bit with Italian American, those people are much more informed than the, you know, 3 or 4 generations earlier of Italian Americans about it. When you don't have that, you know, that validation inside the classroom, the experience at home become the way that you identify with being Italian American. And then everybody uses only their own experience as a way of saying, oh yeah, I know Italian American studies. You know, this happened in my family. That happened in my family. Whereas we know, especially as we began to expand from Italian American to diaspora Italian studies, we know for sure that there are hundreds of thousands of ways of being Italian, Canadian, Italian American, so on, and that we can't say this is the way.
This seems to be sort of our challenge. And now I will go to Giovanni Schiavo, when in 1976, you know, he wrote that those issues associated with whatever he saw, some of the things we're saying today, could have been eradicated a long time ago if Italians, and obviously I think he means Italian and Italian Americans, had the benefit of an enlightened leadership like that of the Jews in America plus this blended philanthropy and spirit of cooperation, which are still absent among the Americans of Italian extraction of today. And I always found this to be very significant because he says Italians at the beginning, and then at the end of that same sentence, he says Americans of Italian extraction of today. So obviously he's using those two adjectives, one word adjective, the other a phrase, in the synonyms. And I think that this sometimes also creates some of the confusion. We've got to find some sort of cohesive point, element. And I thought maybe Italian immigration would be one. But as I've been reminded, that ends at a certain point, or the bulk of it ends at a certain point, or the dynamics of it end at a certain point. And perhaps the term diaspora is more appropriate, because diaspora includes not only other people, but includes the legacy of the immigration.
That's a critical point, because we know from census data that even though direct immigration has lessened tremendously through the 20th century, the number of people who claim Italian identity has grown. So therefore, the diaspora idea becomes extremely important as people try to understand their backgrounds in a way that does allow for greater intellectual pursuit.
Very rarely do I have more than a third of my students, or even, probably even, that's a high number, in my Italian-American classes who are Italian-American. I see these classes as, for the Italian-American, they are identity building. And for those non-Italian-Americans, they are identity stretching classes. Mm-hmm. And this is the key to everything you learn. I mean, my job is not to have my students come to me and say, oh, you're the expert, tell us everything, and then we'll know. No, my job is for them to look at, you know, teach them how to look inside themselves. And what do I do with this knowledge?
It seems to me that, unfortunately, among more junior scholars today, and this is not unique to Italian American studies, I see it across the board for scholars, they seem to be only interested in their own research agenda, right? The idea of a bigger picture or a bigger goal is foreign to them. Or that we all have to work together towards a larger idea of Italian diaspora studies, right? So this is something that is happening all over in colleges, but I think I see it very strongly in Italian American studies these days, where people are only concerned about their work or something in the moment and not something 20 years from now. Right? They're not thinking 20 years from now. They're thinking next week. You need to rebuild. You need something here. You can't just always reach back to how something was when, as you said, that system doesn't exist. And now, as people in the humanities, the idea of getting grants or getting the support is exceedingly difficult if you're outside certain areas. So it becomes very challenging to get the support you need. And the place we need to get it from is those organizations.
But I think we have to educate them about exactly what it is we want them to do. Sometimes we could speak in terms of these wonderful developments that are going on, but they might not see the concrete paths by which they can support it. Mm-hmm. You know, certainly supporting, if they're going to give scholarships to people, let's give them to people who are going to go on and take over leadership roles in the intellectual community, in the academic communities, and so on.
It becomes critical also to tell them exactly what we need, right? Because, you know, when you ask people for money or for philanthropy, you know, it's vague, right? But we know that there are certain organizations, foundations, who have supported lecture series or certain specific endeavors. And to try to get people to understand, it has to be more than student scholarships, right? That's not enough, that it has to be from the top down as well as from the bottom up.
We've been fortunate with the Italian Diaspora Studies Summer Seminar in the funding aspect of it, right? We did the first few years, and there were a number of institutions, Italian American institutions, that provided funding so that we could offer at least 50% of the expense to the fellows. And it's important for us to underscore that this is a professional development program. It's not a class. It's not a class, a regular class. In the sort of, you're not going to just take this class to have an exam. This is something that we hope people, faculty first and foremost, and then doctoral students will come, learn, bring it back to their home institution in the form of a class, a course now a regular class, right? That's going to go on for a semester.
The teachers who teach the course are bigger philanthropists, because what they do that work for in terms of percentage of what they would normally get for a summer program they should be able to write that off on their taxes. Right. But the coursisti have to come to us inspired, in a sense. They have to present a project that they would like to work on. And as they're taking the different seminars, they're being informed with this Italian diaspora studies material, and it works its way into their project, so that we have people who have finished those programs who have come out with books, come out with dissertation chapters, exhibits, essays, short stories, poetry, whatever it is. In other words, they have found a use for this knowledge, and they're advancing the knowledge collectively and through the course of their study. Now, to me, that is the ultimate act of education, is to take somebody from someplace and guide them and have them go off on their own and have them create new things.
And I would add one point to what Fred said, which is that in order for them to do everything he just described, an important message that the students receive in that program is that it's okay to stress their heritage if it's their heritage. Because many people who go out into the world, suddenly they don't want to stress the fact that they're of Italian heritage, or it's not okay to do it. So it gives them a place of strength to say, I can support my own literature, my own language, the ideas from my own community, which I think is also critical.
We're just fortunate enough to be in the situation, structural situation, with something like the Calandra Institute, with the fact that we can call on a good dozen, 15 possible professors, potential professors, or we've had at least that many different people, unique individuals who have been willing to give up 3 weeks because it's a morning to night affair, basically. And it didn't exist before, but it exists for all other humanities, social science disciplines, etc. But it hasn't for Italian diaspora, Italian American, or Italian diaspora studies. And I think that it's important for whoever's going to listen to us here that they do hear that. And our funders from the beginning have been good, but we did find two much larger, significant funders who have really guaranteed the program for at least the next 5 years. And that's something that's really good. All right, listen, thank you guys. Thanks for being with us. And let me thank the audience. Thank you all for watching this episode of Italics. I'm Anthony Tamburri. Arrivederci alla prossima puntata.